I've got to be careful what I say in these videos because we don't want these guys knocking on the door. So, you know, let's not cross the line. I'm only joking. That wouldn't happen. I'm going to tell you everything. I'm going to tell you how to make a nuclear bomb. G'day, smart primates. Grab a coffee. Grab a chair. Hold on. Where's me coffee? We're all about family here, so make sure you subscribe. So you might have heard that Christopher Nolan, the man who created one of the best films ever, Interstellar, is making a little film called Oppenheimer, which is going to follow the true events of the Manhattan Project, Los Alamos. I am excited. So I thought it could be fun if we did something to get excited about this Oppenheimer movie. Maybe learn a little bit before it comes out so you can understand what you're seeing. Make sure you come back every day. We're going to put up another video related to nukes. We're going to talk about different things each day, so make sure you come back for every single video because I know where you live and I know how nukes work. If you're new around here, my name's Dylan. I just dropped out of a PhD in physics to create some fun things, and my AI project is now out and you can use it for free. You can turn your rooms into any interior design style you want. You can renovate your house all for free. You just take a picture, upload it to my site, choose what interior design style you want, and it'll spit it out in like 30 seconds. I'm also about to launch AI My Cars, which will do the same thing and turn your car into like a muscle car and thing. So please come get behind it. But anyway, let's get back to the video. So yesterday, if you were watching, we watched an explosion power comparison. We talked heaps about nukes as well and neutron bombs. Tomorrow, I'm going to watch nuclear bombs destruction comparison. We'll talk about that. And then the 3 days following that, I've also got videos planned. So make sure you come back every day of the week. It's Oppenheimer week. We're going to be celebrating the launch of Oppenheimer, which is still not for a little bit. That's from Crash Bandicoot, right? That was one of the first games I ever played, I reckon. I think Doom and Crash Bandicoot, maybe. Scale of explosion. Anti-tank landmine. These napalm, they spelt it right in this one. Tomahawk air missile. We're not going to talk about the boring stuff. Oh boy. Mob. Yep. Father of all bombs. Neutron bomb. That's what we talked about a lot yesterday. So come check out yesterday's video if you want to see that one. Explosion. Comparison. Halifax explosion. Largest accidental explosion. Hey, that's a nice little thing for size comparison. Little boy. Because today's the first video with the theme of Oppenheimer, I reckon we start with where it all started. So we'll start with little boy as well as fat man. Maybe if we start with the Trinity test. The first nuclear bomb ever. All right, so maybe let's come back to this. Fat man. Only ever been two nuclear bombs that have been used in warfare to date, right? And let's hope they're the only two ever. But it's not looking good with the state of the world currently. I'm sure you guys know all about that. And so these two bombs were Little Boy and Fat Man. So we'll talk a little bit about those. Cobalt bomb. Deadliest bomb used on civilians in World War II. Yes, this one was Hiroshima, and this one's Nagasaki. Horrific tragedies, obviously. Radiation fallout worse than the blast. So this is the first hydrogen bomb. We talked a little bit about this one yesterday. Did you guys know that a scientist once left plans for the hydrogen bomb in the bathroom of a train, which are like 1,000 times stronger than the bombs used on Japan? So it was 1953, and it was John Wheeler. Basically, he lost, you know, this report detailing the hydrogen bomb just a couple months after the first successful test of this thing. And he left the plans in a train's bathroom, and basically they were never seen again. Whoops. There's no evidence that the missing hydrogen bomb document ever found its way into enemy hands, basically. Just lost, likely tossed in the trash by a train employee. Imagine being the service worker who finds discarded papers in the toilet stall, and instead of a newspaper or a magazine, it's your nation's cutting-edge nuclear secrets. I can't really tell from this video, but hydrogen bombs actually release more energy than all of the bombs in World War II and World War I combined. You know, as far as we know. Tunguska meteorite. Ooh, that's a fun thing to talk about. We have done such in a few videos. So I won't hear. Castle Bravo. So that may be one of the videos later in the week. Just for reference, though it probably won't help. In the sun's core, the same amount of energy is about 15 billion of these bombs. These ones are produced every second. So we'll save that one. E-41 thermonuclear bomb. Did you guys know that a nuclear bomb can actually be hotter than the center of our sun? The interior of the sun is one of the hottest places we can imagine, but the hottest place is actually AI interiors. We produce the hottest interiors. We're going to save talking about hydrogen bombs for later videos coming this week in our Oppenheimer celebration, getting ready for Oppenheimer week, because that has a lot to do with fusion, the sun, so we'll talk all about that then. And there we have the Tsar bomber. We talked a little bit about this one yesterday as well, though I'm saving that for another specific video. This is the most powerful bomb ever created, but Mother Nature is far, far deadlier. So this video is meant to just focus on nuclear explosion. Look, we'll watch the rest of the video now, and then we'll come back and talk about some of those nukes, okay? So where are they going to go with this? Krakatoa. Now, we actually could make a bomb bigger than Krakatoa, by the way. And the first one, so the US created two bombs, types of bomb. During that time, right? But the first one was actually called the Gadget, which was, detonated at the Trinity test site in 16th July 1945. And interestingly, Oppenheimer is actually going to be released on the 20th of July, so that's kind of cool. So the Gadget and Fat Man, they're both plutonium implosion type devices, right? Whereas Little Man is like a gun type device, a little bit different. Both of these were fission bombs, which set off like a chain reaction of nuclear fission. Basically, the atomic nuclei of radioactive material is split, which creates different elements, which releases a large amount of energy, splitting more atoms as a result, and that just produces a huge destructive explosion. So if you're wondering where the names come from, the little boy and Fat Man, basically the Fat Man is just a little bit bigger and rounder. Larger bomb, larger explosion. And the Gadget looked like this really weird looking gadget thing. In the little boy, you basically have this bullet-like projectile made of uranium 235 that gets fired at the core, which is made of the same substance, and that sets off the chain reaction, right? Whereas the Fat Man, on the other hand, it uses like a core of plutonium 239, right? And that gets ignited from thousands of pounds of conventional explosives. And that sets off, again, a chain reaction of nuclear fission. All nuclear bombs detonated together, 7,000 megaton TNT. Magnitude 10 earthquake. Yeah, that's never happened. It's a logarithmic scale, and that's why, the one that happened in Turkey recently, which is very sad, that was a 7.8. You might be like, hey, that's close to 10. Go learn about logarithms. Antimatter bomb. Okay. So that should probably be, one of the larger ones, because it's got 100% conversion to energy. The ingredients just convert entirely to energy. This is quite physics-y to talk about this one. As in, like the other ones, you can kind of talk about. There's some stuff related to stuff you've probably heard about, but antimatter is a very foreign thing to most people. Supervolcano eruption. Okay, well, that's silly, because the last one just depends on how much antimatter you have, right? Like, you could theoretically have an endless amount of anti. So I think this is very silly. Like, the antimatter would be, if you just got a decent amount of it, much larger than a supervolcano, even a small amount of it. So that's just a bit strange. Don't get me wrong, these things would be not good for anyone, but just gotta, we gotta keep it real. If a supervolcano were to erupt in the USA, everything within 800 kilometer radius will be obliterated instantly. Half the USA population will be wiped out. That's probably not true. Millions more will die within the next few hours. Yeah, maybe. Whole of Earth will be covered with smoke for years. That one, yeah, that last bit, there is quite a bit of research into a nuclear winter in an event of a supervolcano where so much, dirt and soot is blown into the atmosphere that it just stays up there and blocks the sun for a couple of years or a few years, which is not going to be good for crops, and there'll be famine. Eruption will be visible from space. kind of shows you how small these, you know, bombs are, though, in comparison. Outer space decides to play a game. So we're going to bring asteroids in. Oh, yeah. 65 million. It's like it just disappeared for a while. Like this rate at which it was moving, and then it just, nothing's happening. This is the asteroid that wiped out all dinosaurs. It released an energy equivalent to 50 billion Hiroshima atomic bombs, 10 million megatons of TNT, and create mega tsunamis 100 meters high. Smoke covered the whole Earth for the next few decades, and reduced all life on Earth by 70%. All right, they've gone to extremes now. This is, I don't know, if we're taking a step up, maybe the sun has exploded, which it will in about 4.5 billion years. So, you know, if you're having a bad day, if you're having a rough one, just remember it doesn't matter. The sun's going to explode in like 5 billion years. Or this could be a supernova. That would also be bad, but there's no stars locally that should go supernova. But then there's also hypernovas, which, you know, have a kill zone of more like, you know, a quarter of the Milky Way size, which could be bad if there was one, you know, kind of within the vicinity, and that's possible. Then there's also more exotic things like the jets of quasars. You know, we don't need to talk about that one. I talk about them all the time. You know, the active galactic nuclei of galaxies when the black holes are eating so much matter, these jets perpendicular fire up and just launch out these giant beams of energy. So supernovas and stuff really such a gamma ray burst. Gamma ray burst completely destroyed Earth. Again, Earth would not be completely destroyed. It just would be bad for our atmosphere. So they went with the hypernova situation. We actually think one of the mass extinction events in Earth's history might have been caused by a hypernova. So most of the physics behind these atomic fission bombs is available to the public, but there are still some things that will be kept secret. Like the physics behind how they work and behind their explosive power. You could find that on the internet. But some of the specific information related to like the precise configuration of nuclear material within the fission bomb, as well as the exact timing and sequence of the explosive events that trigger the fission chain reaction, may be classified. So there are still plenty of secrets, and there's lots of interesting stuff happening during, you know, when we were making these bombs about, you know, Born Secret, how some of this information was try to keep completely secret in terms of the just physics, which was strange. And I read a book about it once. It was really interesting. And tomorrow we're going to watch nuclear bombs destruction comparison. So that looks really awesome. So make sure you come back. Go check out AI My Interior for free. Make sure you subscribe because I know how nukes work and I know where you live.